Water change day here in the gallery, but today I kind of want to talk about the freshwater stingray and are they or are they not dangerous in the home aquarium. Now you guys know that I have a 2,000 gallon aquarium. It's 10 feet long, 7 feet wide, 4 feet tall. It houses 5 freshwater stingrays and 3 Asian arowana. Now I've been keeping freshwater stingrays for about 10 years or more now, and one of the biggest questions I get is, have you ever been stung? The simple answer to that is no. Later on in the video, I'll talk about how I've been able to avoid and the precautions that I've taken in not getting stung. But there's a number of other questions that come to mind for me. One is, what happens if you get stung by a stingray? What if a stingray stings another stingray? What if a stingray stings another fish? I guess we should kind of dive into more information on the stinger, on the stingray first. You see, technically it's actually not a stinger. That's just what a lot of people call it based on its name, stingray. I didn't name the stingray, but it's a great name based on this. If I were to name them, I probably would have named them flappy water pancakes maybe, but that's not my job. The stinger is actually called a barb. Let's talk about what this is made out of. You'd think something as hard and as potentially dangerous as this would be made out of bone, but it's not. You see, the stingray is an elasmobranch. It's a subclass of cartilaginous fish, home to the shark, the skates, as well as the stingrays. The stingray doesn't have a single bone in its body. This is literally hardened cartilage. In fact, its entire body structure or bone structure is replaced by hardened cartilage. One of the other interesting things they have in common with the shark is that you guys know sharks over time shed their teeth. Whether they get dull, they break out, it gets lodged in a prey. Basically, the shark is always growing new teeth. Unlike us, we only have 2 sets of teeth, our baby teeth and our adult teeth. Sharks have forever teeth and rays have forever barbs. The way the barbs work, they'll always have one in place and another one is usually always growing on top or below. And as soon as it's fully grown in, the old barb falls off or sheds, especially if it hasn't been pierced into something and ripped out. And the new barb remains, and it's usually even bigger. The barbs obviously grow with the size of the ray. A term I hear a lot used with stingrays is poison, or poisonous stingrays. Stingrays are not poisonous, they're venomous. A big difference between venom and poison is the way it's actually delivered to the victim. Venom is injected with a bite or a pierce like this, whereas poison is consumed or absorbed for the most part. Not only are these extremely sharp and very tough, but obviously they inject a venom. And if we look closely at the barb, we can see underneath of it there's a groove. Now this is a cleaned barb. All of my barbs have been cleaned. They usually have a skin over top of it. When the barb enters some flesh, that skin is peeled back. That groove underneath the barb is where that venom will be, and it starts to inject that venom into the wound. Now, because this has serrated edges, it can cause a lot of damage being ripped out, or it can simply lodge itself in there and the barb will remain, obviously delivering even more venom. Okay, now that we understand the barbs a little bit more, let's talk about what actually happens in the scenarios when something gets stabbed by it. But before we go any further, I want to make something abundantly clear. The stingray's barb is not an attack mechanism or an attack tool, it's for defense. You can know this by simply looking at the location of it. The ray's mouth is underneath the ray, the barb is on top on the tail, meaning that it's there to protect anything that's coming from above. Now, 1 to 2 people die every year from being stabbed in the chest by a stingray barb, usually saltwater rays because they get substantially larger than most of the freshwater stingrays. Being stabbed in anything else but your chest, a lot of the times is going to be pretty much harmless. Sort of, we'll get to that in a minute. Being stabbed in the chest obviously means it could hit vital organs like your heart, for example. So obviously getting stabbed by something that is 10 times bigger than this into the heart is probably going to kill you. But a lot of times, a lot of divers and snorkelers are swimming above these rays. The rays see the shadow. They might see it as a potential predator, like a tiger shark, for example, that might be going after the ray, and they strike up at it. Again, only in defense or being scared or trying to ward off a potential attacker. otherwise, these guys are like little water puppies, and we all know that you can go to resorts and swim with rays and they'll eat from your hands, and they're really inquisitive and personable and interested and curious creatures. It's part of why I really like them. But what if something like this gets stabbed directly into your hand? I can tell you it's not gonna take much pressure to actually pierce my skin. Well, obviously that's gonna hurt. Nobody likes getting stabbed. But the venom is going to be injected, and since it's neurotoxin, it's going to be incredibly painful. I've never been stabbed, but based off of the stories of other freshwater stingray keepers, I can assure you, just based on their testimonies alone, here's what they describe as happening. Obviously the stabbing hurts, but it's an immediate excruciating pain. They describe it as their hand feeling like it's going to explode. It's incredibly painful. Some say that the pain travels up their arm. Others state that they got headaches and started to become nauseated. They went to the hospital, but the hospital couldn't do anything because there is no anti-venom for stingrays. You have to run the wound under as hot as water as you possibly could bear in an attempt to coagulate the venom, is what I assume. And the pain will subside after about 24 hours or so. But all of them saying that they have never felt that sort of pain. They would have rather cut their hand off type of deal. I can only imagine how much pain you'd have to be in to consider cutting your hand off. But then we have a problem, because freshwater stingrays give birth to live young, fully formed pups is what we call them. Now these pups are also born with barbs. Let me show you. These tiny little ones at one point belong to tiny little pups. They do have them, they are born with them, they are sharp, they are serrated, and they do have the grooves underneath indicating to me that there would have been venom present. So even a cute little adorable 3-4 inch tiny little pup is still potentially dangerous. But we're gonna cover what we can do to prevent getting stabbed here in a few moments. Next thing that comes up is, what if a stingray stings another stingray? There's only really a couple of circumstances that happen in the home aquarium where a stingray will sting another stingray. You see, they're not actually territorial. They're not going to fight for areas in the tank. They don't care. They're always just searching for food. They're more of a scavenger than a predator. Until it comes to breeding time, the males can be especially aggressive, making sure the female breeds when he wants to, whether she's ready to or not a lot of the times. And that's when one ray can stab another. The female will protect herself. Or like I've mentioned already, the rays can shed their barbs in the aquarium. And if you don't find them in time, the ray can probably swim up against it, lodge it into its mouth or something along those lines, into its disc, stabbing itself that way. Interestingly enough, I have seen rays get stabbed before, and as long as it doesn't hit a vital organ, they seem to be perfectly fine. I've also seen people net stingrays that have had lodged barbs in them, and they simply netted them, took some pliers, pulled the barb out, put the ray back in the tank, and he was perfectly fine. Which brings the question up is, we know that fish feel pain, just not in the same way we do, but do stingrays feel venom from other stingrays? It's interesting because they don't react in any sort of way. But what if a stingray stings another fish in your aquarium? This happens sometimes, not often, but it's usually in an aquarium where the aquarium's not properly sized. Once again, if the fish isn't stabbed in its vital organs, they survive just fine as well, going along their day. But again, like I said, fish don't feel pain in the same way we feel it, so I'm not sure if they're feeling that venom or if it has to hit a vital organ. I'd love to get your guys' thoughts and ideas, opinions on that. Let me know in the comment section below. What do you think is actually happening when a... Do you think the rays are feeling the venom? Do you think other fish feel it? All I know is that 90% of the time if a ray stings another ray or a fish, it usually survives. So you got a stingray and you don't want to get stung. I've seen so many comments in the comment section of my videos of people telling me things I should do. And some of it is pretty bizarre, and I know for a fact they do not keep stingrays. But some of the common things that happen during shipping a stingray is they will take the barb, or the base of the tail, they'll hold the ray with their barb exposed, put a piece of airline tubing on it, just like this, snip it off so that the barb can't pierce the bag. Now, once you get it home, if you can, maybe you could pull it off. I don't bother with it. I just let the barb eventually fall out. It usually falls out every 3 to 4 months anyway, sometimes a little sooner, sometimes a little later, depending on the fish, the size of it, and of course its diet and environment. Another thing shippers do, they will simply snip the ends off. So sometimes you'll get a barb with the end snipped off. That's simply so it cannot pierce the bag. Now, obviously catching your stingray and putting on a air hose or snipping it off every few months isn't going to be practical. It's going to be stressing the fish out, causing acute stress, and eventually the ray might potentially die due to this. So obviously that's not going to be a practical idea to prevent getting stung. Now, when I said there has been recommendations from people that obviously don't keep rays, the recommendation was, why don't you just pull it out? Sure, let me pull your fingernails out. Very similar, this is lodged in their flesh. This isn't just hanging there, they feel it. Ripping the barb out is gonna grow back anyways, but you're also creating a wound, which could lead to secondary infection and potentially loss of the ray. So that is not only cruel and unethical, but it's entirely unhealthy for the ray as well. Even others have said, why don't you just cut its tail off? Like some fishermen do when they catch a stingray, they'll cut its tail off to and throw it back, whatever the case might be. I don't have anything nice to say about that or the type of people that do that, so we'll skip it. But yet there's still three things we can kind of do to prevent getting stung. One, we know that the barbs are going to be shed every few months, so keep an eye out for them and simply remove it with a net. Once you get it out, you can boil it in hot water. That should get rid of all the venom and most of the skin. Once that's done, you can scrub it off with a toothbrush and you can keep it, just like I do. I love finding these because I like collecting them. Just gotta keep them in a safe place. Second thing of preventing getting stung by a stingray is ensuring that you are constantly aware and you respect the actual animal. No sudden movements, you don't come from above the ray, you don't come from behind the ray. Very simple. Don't move quickly, don't move fast. If it spooks, get out of the tank. Very, very simple. In a stingray aquarium though, you rarely need to be in the aquarium because since they are a bottom dweller and they're constantly undulating their fins or their disc, they are allowing all the debris that would typically collect on the bottom to be taken up and removed by the filtration system. So a lot of the time, stingray aquariums tend to be a lot of the cleanest of aquariums. Not mine, I gotta clean this panel. Isn't he gorgeous? Ooh, gives me chills. If you're only keeping stingrays, the size of the aquarium doesn't really come into much of a factor as long as you have ample gallonage as well as surface area. Now I wanna do a video on how to take care of stingrays and like a profile type of deal. If you wanna see that, make sure you're subscribed if you're not already. Or let me know in the comment section below that you do indeed want more on stingrays. But to summarize, the height of the aquarium doesn't necessarily matter. I've bred stingrays in as little as 16 inches of water. Maybe it was like closer to 15 inches of water or 14 inches of water, if I remember correctly, which is only, you know, 2 inches more than a foot, which was perfectly fine. That's actually a debatable subject on how tall a stingray needs, but I've, like I said, I've had success in shorter tanks. The only time the height, in my opinion, comes into play is when you have other tank mates for obvious reasons. You want them as far away from the rays as you can possibly get. Obviously, you also want to keep fish that are not going to attack the rays, but that's a topic for another day. In my opinion, when it comes to keeping tank mates with rays, you want to do 24 to 30 inches of tank height minimum, or if you're crazy enough, go 4 feet tall like me. So really, it just comes down to common sense and respect of the animal, and I think that many of you get that.